Normal Life will not be seen tonight due to the following Channel 3 special.
This is an Eyewitness News special. The UConn Huskies, the dream season. I'm Jerry Brooks at the Gamble Pavilion in Storrs. The song is Synchronicity. The word means the perfect blend when every cog just meshes together. That's the story of the UConn Huskies this year. It was a season of synchronicity from the players and coaches to you, the fans.
029499.
It was the kind of season that saw 1,600 people pack the old field house for a chance at one of only 100 playoff tickets. It was the kind of team that drew 5,000 fans to an open practice at the Hartford Civic Center.
Let's go!
It was a special time that saw a blue and white pep rally compete with the green of St. Patty's Day.
Go, Huskies! Here we go!
Everyone became fans. Blue and white abounded. The players became heroes.
Here goes the long pass with 1 second to go. The shot.
And a heart-stopping play became the talk of the state.
What was to become the dream season began in, of all places, Anchorage, Alaska, against Texas A&M. The season began with a loss. Phil Andrews takes us back.
The 1989-90 dream season began in, of all places, our 49th state, where the Huskies opened the school's first-ever 30-game regular season by winning 2 of 3 games in the Great Alaska Shootout. From there, Connecticut would build a 7-1 record before opening their Big East schedule with a loss to Villanova, and then a 31-point blowout to St. John's in Jamaica, New York. Ironically, it was the loss to the Redmen that proved to be the turning point of the dream season, as the Huskies won their next 15 games, including a 70-59 upset over then-5th-ranked Syracuse, and just 6 days later, a 70-65 victory over 2nd-ranked Georgetown.
On January 24th, the Huskies played their final home game here in the old Storrs Fieldhouse, when they beat Central Connecticut 99-77, and then, just 3 nights later, moved down the hall to christen the brand-new multi-million-dollar Gamble Pavilion Sports Complex.
The night also offered a chance for revenge. The Huskies knocked off 15th-ranked St. John's 72-58 to up their Big East record to 7-2 and their overall mark to 17-3. Then on February 24th, Connecticut played their final home game of the regular season as Husky fans bid a fond farewell to co-captain Tate George, the team's only senior, then proceeded to dismantle Seton Hall 79-57. And just a week later, the Huskies traveled to Chestnut Hill, Massachusetts, where they plucked the Boston College Eagles 95-74 to join Syracuse as the co-champs of the Big East's regular season title. Up next, a trip to the Big East tournament at Madison Square Garden.
Thanks, Phil. Huskies coach Jim Calhoun is in Denver tonight, site of the Final Four that he came so very close to. And as Calhoun arrives in Denver, he arrives not only as the Big East coach of the year, but the national coach of the year as well.
To be honored by one peers is a little different than being honored by others, and I think that in this case, with the coaches voting and determining us National Coach of the Year, and I say us, I mean our team, and me being a representative, I think it's very, very special. I think that I'll get a few handshakes, which isn't probably the worst thing in the world. It's humbling in many ways, because you look who went before you, but nevertheless, I it's really, once again, a reflection of what we did as opposed to maybe what I did. The best thing that's come out of it is people's expressions of what it shows, what a group of people with a singleness of purpose on a particular goal can do if they do it together. And I think that's what we've proven. And I think I've said to the kids all along, you know, remember that if we all work hard and we do it together, then I, meaning each one of us, will be rewarded. Dove says he can't even tell his friends the passion that people have for the program. He can't tell people in Israel. How can I tell people in Boston just how special? I told a friend yesterday, the president of Northeastern, Jack Curry, president Dr. Curry, and he's a good friend, and he said, what's it really like? And I said, well, think about the Celtics, the Bruins, the Patriots, and Red Sox rolled into one and having a great year. And he said, really? I said, really? The competition during the 2 hours that I compete, that's just me. That's just how I compete. But if you look, my team plays the same way I coach, with a great deal of passion, a great deal of emotion. Bobby Hurley said something kind of funny. He said that some teams, you can feel their defensive pressure. He said the Connecticut kids played you so close, you could feel their breath. He had some misty eyes when I rode up that hill and saw 6,000 people waiting for us. And as I told him at the time, you know, we had a lot of broken hearts, and what we needed was a big hug. And we got 6,000 hugs, which is, you know, exactly what the doctor ordered for us. But that was very emotional, because the Dove gets off the bus, and I use him as an example, because the other kid said some things. But he said to me, "Coach, look at them. We could have given them so much more." By Sunday, I wasn't so composed. I was by myself, and a long run, could still see Kate with the ball. One more bounce, inbounds, the game is over. It doesn't, they have a chance, and so on. So I really haven't got a chance to probably sit back and reflect and say, well, this has really been something special. I know it has been, but yeah. I haven't had a chance to kind of take a deep breath and really look at it. But we will get away in parts of April and May and try to run, get together with my family, play some golf, which would be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to that. But right now, once again, it's probably a good month before I can kind of tone down, because there's just too much to do now.
Questions about the coach's future are answered this way. I'm very happy here at UConn, and we're already planning ahead to next season. Coming up, some of his players have their say when we come back.
UConn Huskies, the dream season.
Welcome back. When the Big East coaches get together before the season starts, they predict the order of finish for the year, and the prediction for the UConn Huskies was eighth place. Phil Andrews now reminds us that the season really became a dream one special week in January.
The Big East tournament festivities officially began on the afternoon of March 8th when Jim Calhoun appropriately awarded Conference Coach of the Year honors. Now, in quarterfinal play of last year's Big East tournament, the Seton Hall Pirates were the number 2 seed and the Huskies the number 7 seed. This year, however, same two teams, but the seedings reversed, as was the final outcome, as Connecticut walloped P.J. Colissimo's Pirates 70-58. Now, that quarterfinal victory over Seton Hall helped pave the way for the Huskies to accomplish a feat that no other team in Big East history had ever done. Beat both Georgetown and Syracuse in the same tournament. Now, in the Georgetown game, the Hoyas jumped out to a 36-30 halftime lead. And remember, up to this point, Connecticut was 0-5 when trailing at the half. But in the final 20 minutes, the Huskies held Georgetown to a 25% field goal performance from the floor as they eventually won it 65-60 and a ticket to the title game against top seed Syracuse, where, for the second time in 3 meetings this season, Jim Calhoun and company able to beat the Orange Men to claim the school's first ever Big East tournament title, as guards Chris Smith, John Gwynn, and Tate George were nominated for the all-tournament team, with Smith also collecting MVP honors. Up next, the school's first trip to the NCAA tournament in 11 years.
Thanks, Phil. Let's meet a few of the guys who helped make this a dream season. With us in the Husky locker room are co-captains Steve Peichel and Tate George, and Dan Cerulik and Scott Burrell. You know, we just finished seeing Phil Andrews' review of the Big East season, and one thing that, you know, I don't know if you guys really got a chance to enjoy, was winning the Big East title, those back-to-backers over Georgetown and Syracuse. Then you hopped right into the NCAA. Well, let's start with you, Steve. Kind of a blur?
Yeah, it happened so fast. Like, when we played Georgetown and we played Syracuse, and as soon as the game was over, we were preparing for the NCAA tournament already. We got the seedings, and then we came home and started getting ready for Boston University. So we really didn't have time to sit back and, like, realize what we have accomplished.
Just now, a couple days after, we're kind of starting to reflect on what we really did this season.
One thing Coach did talk about when I interviewed him earlier was how perceptions of people change. He's been going to the same church, and, you know, he's there every Sunday, no big deal. Then all of a sudden, he's on CBS, and Brent and Billy are talking to him, and Hubie and Dick and everybody, and all of a sudden, he said people looked at him a little bit differently. Have you found that, Scott, since you've been back?
Well, yeah, because when you win, a lot more people start liking you and stuff, and I'm going to get more attention, and it's good sometimes, but sometimes it's tiring, because sometimes you don't think it's true. Like, people really want to talk to you. They just talk to you because you're winning.
Yeah.
But, you know, when we came back here to a big crowd, however many people there were, they kind of made it think kind of a second time, and maybe they aren't such family.
Believe me, it's tiring, and more than anything, I want to miss the guys more than most people may think. Not just the competitiveness, but the little things that we have the jokes there, but the nickname he's got.
He's kind of on the flip side as the other co-captain. Your career has taken a different turn because of injuries.
I'm like anyone else. I think I should, you know, play a lot and everything. And I also realize, though, that John Gwynn and Chris Smith and Tate George are, you know, pretty good ball players that I'm playing behind. It's not like, you know, playing behind chopped liver. These guys can really play the game. And I realize, you know, that my turn will come hopefully next year, and I got to work hard this summer, and hopefully it will. But I just think this year, no matter who played on the court, it was, we just had a special team, a special chemistry, and everybody seemed to fit themselves into the piece of the puzzle.
It started during the summer. I had the piece of paper that we wrote the outline on, and we went step by step about respect each other's wishes and unity and chemistry and believe in ourselves, believe in the system, and I showed them a couple weeks ago before we made the run to the Final Eight, and we laughed about it because how far we've come, and it really became a part of us.
Scott, your high for the season?
Winning the Big East Championship, nobody expected us to come in the running at all and pick the eighth, and you know, just winning the Big East Championship is a big thrill for me.
Yeah.
I have to agree with Scott, you know, winning the Big East Championship, you know, we've come a long way, even from last year when I was here the first year. No one expected us. They picked us eighth in the beginning of the season, preseason, all those Big East polls and stuff like that, you know, just to come up and win the whole thing. That's a big thrill for me.
I just think it was the Big East regular season when we beat Boston College that day, because I played in so many Big East games, and Tate and I have been through so many wars, and that's 16 games. It's not a Big East tournament, it was three games. And that was 16 games, accumulation of 16 games, and we were the best team.
Shout against Clemson. Doesn't get any higher than that. Not unless it's illegal.
Thanks, guys. There will be new faces joining these gentlemen next season. The recruiting game is a tough one, but success has a way of breeding success. Our Mike Adams has that story.
One of the most wonderful angles to the Huskies' dream season is the promise of next season. Tate George will no doubt be missed, but the rest of the guys will be back. Howie Dickenman is Coach Calhoun's recruiting specialist, and his efforts have extended UConn's talent pool from here to Tel Aviv.
Well, Jim is very good in that he allows Dave Lato and myself to just go and has enough confidence in us that he'll take our word if we feel someone is good enough to play here. The lifeblood of this program is recruiting.
A couple of key UConn players were recruited from within state borders, Chris Smith from Bridgeport and Scotty Burrell from Hamden. But more Husky hoop help is on the way, and it comes from right here, Farmington High School.
Sean Ellison is almost 6 feet 8 inches tall and may still be growing. He was signed to play for UConn back in November after averaging 20 points a game at Farmington, and he couldn't be happier about his decision.
I think they can go even further than the Final Four. I think they can go all the way. The team coming back from this year, with the exception of Tate George, they get someone to fill in that role, I think. Be unbelievable.
Let's not forget another potential Husky on the horizon. A smart player, great outside shot from E.O. Smith and Stores. First name, Jeff. Last name, Calhoun.
Jim will have to go home into his living room, and because he doesn't see a lot of it during the recruiting period, he'll have to make an appointment to see Jeff, sit down in his living room, introduce himself to his wife, Pat, okay? Say, I'm Jim, I'm your husband, and I'd like to talk to our son.
Mike Adams, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
Temple's nearly deserted right now, but you can still imagine 8,000 voices cheering on their Huskies. And for every voice here, there were thousands more all around this state. Coming up, you, the fans. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You know, if success breeds success on the court, well, you'd better believe it's the same story off the court, too.
Let's start at the top. The university's athletic program will make as much as $800,000 from the team's appearance in the NCAA tournament. Then there's Coach Calhoun. His $84,000 salary will undoubtedly go up, and he'll make more money from his contract with Nike sneakers and other bonus money as well. And don't forget the souvenir vendors. UConn paraphernalia sold faster than it could be made. From local bars with big screen TVs, where patrons jam them on playoff nights to share in the Husky excitement.
Of course, the biggest windfall comes from participation in the NCAA tournament. Phil Andrews has those unforgettable memories from the Hartford Civic Center and the Meadowlands.
By virtue of their Big East tournament title win over Syracuse, the NCAA had no other choice but to make UConn the East's number one seed and send them to the Hartford Civic Center, where they breezed through their opening round games with a 24-point win over 16-seed Boston University and a 20-point win over 9th-seeded California. From Hartford, well, it was on to the tournament's Sweet 16 in East Rutherford, New Jersey, where the Huskies blew a 19-point lead to 5th-seed Clemson before Scott Burrell and Tate George hooked up for the shot as UConn's split-second win over the Tigers propelled them into the Final Eight, where they were eventually eliminated in overtime by Duke as Christian Laettner's 12-footer at the buzzer brought the dream season and a quest for the Final Four to an end.
Now, as tough as that loss to Duke really was, spirits were soon lifted when the Huskies returned here to the Gapple Pavilion and the open embrace of thousands of adoring fans.
And by you coming out here, you've mended those broken hearts and you've put a place that we'll remember the rest of our lives. Thanks, all.
They lost at the buzzer, but it didn't matter. The team returned to Storrs as champions. For if part of the mission of an athletic squad is to foster allegiance to its cause, then the UConn Huskies won big.
We love you, baby!
Fans watched UConn soar to the Final Eight, and they rose to the occasion in a show of support never before seen on campus.
And of course, tonight there will be talk of the NIT championship game. I was a student here when UConn won the NIT in 1988. That, too, was historical for us, and the campus exploded with pride. We never thought we would be able to top those feelings of joy that we had that season, but oh, how wrong we were.
And some say the dream could not have come at a better time.
Especially now with the problems of the budget cuts, library closing, there's a lot of real problems on campus.
When I came to the school, I wasn't even thinking of the, you know, the sports part of it, but it's made this year really special. You know, it's probably going to be one of my most special years.
But the pride in these Huskies stretched far beyond the borders of the little town called Storrs. This best season ever captured everyone's heart, made Husky fans out of everyone. You'll understand if it's been tough to concentrate these last few weeks, for some worse than others. Now the team and their fans are doing a fast break on the books. Things should be back to normal at UConn soon. Well, as normal as can be expected. David Ushery, Channel 3 Eyewitness News, Storrs.
That's what memories are made of. We'll be right back. They come from Carolina and Jersey, Florida and Michigan, Israel and Germany. But along with 6 homegrown players, they all wear Connecticut across the front of their uniforms. And they turned on the state of Connecticut like no group of young men has turned on this state before. Future teams may be more talented, but none will be more fun, more exciting, more lovable. Through hard work and teamwork, they made dreams come true and believers of us all.
That the thought of leaving is going through your mind. Remember what we have is rare and very hard to find. Until you believe, I will try my best to show you what we have is real. Until you
the long pass with 1 second to go. The shot. Yes! The shot's gonna go! The shot by Tate George wins it.
Until you believe, I will try my best to show you what we have is real.
Hennefeld with two. Gets it outside. A three-point shot by Nadav Hennefeld with 1 second on the clock.
Giving up on you would be like giving up on myself. I know your heart will guide you, but could use a little help.
What the heck? Let's see it one more time.
Here goes the long pass with 1 second to go. The shot. Yes! The shot's gonna count! The shot by Tate George wins it!